topic, which was NAND flash memory. So I parse it into basics, key scaling challenges, and future outlook. So how do we make things today? What are the basics? How do we make things today? And then how are we going to make things tomorrow and day after? Outline is a quick review of product trends, a device primer, how does a basic flash floating gate cell really work, technology scaling, which is, you're trying to make things smaller and cheaper and better and faster. How do we really do that? What are the key challenges that we face in terms of scaling of flash? We probably are a little bit more familiar with standard CMOS scaling. We'll try to compare and contrast that with how flash is scaled. And then I'll summarize my talk. What is flash memory most commonly used for? So we started off with tapes, then we went to disks, SD cards. Now we have smartphones. Please note the smartphone I have here has Intel Medfield architecture inside. Consider that as the best smartphone there is. With my shameless appeal for Intel out. So we have a lot of things, music, video, phone, all that stuff. It is integrated into a smartphone. And a whole bunch of us, I'm probably exaggerating, but probably all of us have a smartphone which is using a whole bunch of flash. And the real key enabler for that kind of a technology has been flash. So it's affecting our day-to-day life. And it's kind of makes me pretty happy that we can actually do that and still have fun doing all the technical stuff that we do. Outlook. So flash TAM today, total available market, is somewhere in the $27 billion range. We expect it to grow 2x in the next 4 or 5 years. These are projections, so all projections have a hockey stick in the next future, but these are projections, and we do expect that. And the real growth is going to come from, like Professor Saraswat mentioned, from SSDs. So if you look at where we are today, we have a pretty small fraction of the whole NAND TAM going into SSDs, and that's where we make money. That's the attach ratios that we talk about in terms of people who are actually using SSDs in their laptops is still very small. It's not even hit double digits yet. So you can see the opportunity to grow is humongous. I have a SSD, I've had it for the last 5 years. I'm sure Professor Saraswat has it too. And it really, you can feel the difference. It's much more rugged. A whole bunch of things are much better about flash. So, and that is the key growth opportunity we see. And it is expected to be the largest market, and we are seeing those trends even in industry today. So yes, SSDs will be the next big thing, and computers will be the next big thing for flash, which will keep the growth going going forward. So before going into the next thing, which is like a device physics primer, one thing is feel free to ask questions at any point of time. Let's make this interactive, fun, and so we all actually get something out of this talk. So feel free to ask me questions at any point of time. Basics of a flash memory. So a floating gate flash memory looks quite a bit like a transistor, but with some key differences. You have a poly-1 floating gate between what we usually think of as a transistor. You have a tunnel oxide, silicon dioxide for the tunnel oxide. You have an interpoly dielectric, which is ONO, oxide, nitride oxide. And you have source drain junctions, which are optimized for this particular operation. So you can electrically have an equivalent circuit saying you have a transistor, which has a floating gate node, and it couples to the entire world around it through different capacitances. For example, it couples to the drain, it couples to the source, it couples to the substrate, as well as the control gate. Electrically, pictorially described as a dot line between the gate and the substrate. The fundamental property of a flash cell is essentially and can be boiled down to just one, which is a gate coupling ratio, and you want to maximize this as much as possible. So it'll be how much the control gate controls your floating node, as opposed to the entire world that controls your floating node. So you'll notice that as we go along, and I talk about scaling challenges, it is this parameter that keeps degrading as the rest of the parasitics start controlling the floating gate more and more. How does a flash work? Pretty straightforward. You put electrons, or you take away electrons from the floating gate. Programming means putting electrons on, and that pushes your threshold voltage high because you need that much higher gate overdrive to actually get inversion. And erasing means removing electrons from the floating gate, and that gets you to the low VT state. Number of electrons that you put is very proportional to the VT shift, and it goes through the control gate or the CIPD that we have there. So you can notice that for a given threshold voltage shift, if your capacitance starts going down, you're going to need smaller and smaller number of electrons to actually program, which becomes a pretty big scaling limiter also. NAND and NOR, I'm sure basics of NAND and NOR are pretty known, so wanted to have a differentiator slide, but I'm going to skip that for speed. We have two most popular types of NAND, which are NAND and NOR, the equivalent circuit which we talked about. Pretty big differences in the way things are connected electrically. In a NOR cell, each cell is actually connected to the bit line directly, with the source being common to the whole block. I started working in NOR, so it was pretty nice that I could actually go and measure a single cell when I was trying to make arrays and products out of that, so I could exactly know the IV of that cell, and being connected allows me to do that. But when you go to NAND, what you see is it's essentially a string of serially connected cells. Current state of the art is about 64, and people are playing with 128 cells in a string also. It's connected to a bit line through a select transistor. So you're trying to make a whole bunch of these NAND transistors, but you don't really have access to the source or the drain of an individual transistor. When I really started working on this, it was pretty worrisome to me that I don't know how a single cell behaves. How am I going to create a whole bunch of gigabyte kind of arrays? And it does pose a problem, but you can figure out ways around it to actually get the electrical information that you really want. In terms of a cross-section, you can see the same thing pictorially, where in a NOR cell, for every cell, there is a drain contact and a source. Every cell has a drain contact and a source. So you have access to each and every cell, whereas in a NAND cell, you have two select transistors at the end, and you have a whole bunch of lines and spaces, which is a string of 32, 64, 128 strings in the middle that you don't really need to access. The strength of having not having contacts for every cell is a lack of an individual cell results in a very small NAND size. So we are close to litho limit, or actually even beyond litho limit, in terms of 4 lambda squared, the smallest dimension that can be printed and resolved. Yes, the select gates add overhead. So you can see you have two select gates per X number of strings. And like I mentioned, the trend is to go bigger and bigger in terms of the string length. And the sole reason for that is to amortize the select gate overhead over larger number of word lines. So this overhead just keeps looking smaller and smaller as you go to larger and larger strings. And that's the reason we go to longer string length. So not having contacts really makes this an extremely area efficient technology. So the fact that you have bit access versus not leads to very different applications in the floating gate structures. NAND is essentially a dominant memory for data storage because it can provide very high throughput and very high density at a very low cost. It is not something where you can access one bit and suddenly the whole access time scales down. It pretty much takes you the same time to access one bit as 16K bytes. So random access is very slow, so you can't really use NAND for execute in place or any of those things. NOR, on the other hand, is mainstream for code storage, and it can it has very fast random access program and very suitable for code kind of applications. It is less suitable for data storage because it has lower throughput, and because of the contact to every cell, it is very area inefficient. So it's higher cost as well. A cartoon cross-section essentially is as simple as it really gets. You have word lines and bit lines in checkerboard fashion, and that's the heart of a flash cell. So equivalently, you can see you have bit lines running across the whole block. You have word lines running across word lines, and you are making a cross point, in some sense, a cross point array there where you have a transistor between a word line and a bit line. In terms of the word line cross sections, we've already looked at it. You have word line source, and that's the way the string works. And on the other direction, you have a floating gate followed by a wrap of the word line. So we talked about properties. We talked about how the structure looks like. So let's change gears and go into how a basic operation of the NAND flash really works. So you need to do only three things with any memory. You want to write it, you want to erase it, and you want to be able to read what you just wrote. So let's start with the read. How does you really read a NAND flash cell, especially since I mentioned a few minutes ago that I don't have access to a particular cell? It's pretty much like we try to read a NAND circuit. So the cell that you're trying to read is, say, the blue cell that you're trying to read. We want to take all the rest of the cells out of the equation. So we apply a high voltage on the rest of the word lines to make them essentially pass transistors with as low of a voltage drop as possible. So that's how you bias the array. You want to make the cell target cell to be the determinant of the entire resistance, and the rest of the string has to be as low a resistance as possible. You charge up the bit line. You select essentially the particular string. This is kind of an important thing, especially when you're trying to build an array, that you can select a block and keep the rest of the blocks deselected. That way, your data is essentially telling you what this block is written, and you're not getting any disturbed signals from other blocks. Keep the selector word lines at zero, and if the cell VT was programmed, which is a high VT, this string is not going to conduct any current, and you know that the cell that you're talking about is indeed programmed. Well, as if the cell VT is less than zero, it's going to discharge the whole bit line, and you're going to be able to sense that as well. You can see that I want, from an operation point of view, I want to apply as high a pass voltage as possible so that the pass resistance becomes really small. But there are practical limits, because once you go to a very high limit, very high voltage, you're actually going to start soft programming the cell, and that will lead to a disturb, like a read disturb. So that's the boundary that we are always trying to play, that you want to be as high as possible for functionality, but as low as possible from a reliability point of view. In the earlier cartoon, I showed you two cells. So that would be your single level cell. So you either put electrons or you don't put electrons in the cell, and that's how that's the number of bits you get. You can go kind of crazy about with that idea and extrapolate it to as many level cells as you want. So SLC is not really that much that common these days. It's quite expensive, and that's NAND. Name of the game in NAND is essentially cost, and SLC offers you very high performance, but doesn't really go anywhere in terms of cost. So MLC, where you are actually putting four levels instead of the two, gives you two bits in effectively the same area. So straight up drops your cost by a factor of two. There are some overheads involved that I need to be a little smarter with the way I make a die when I'm doing MLC versus SLC. So the savings is not directly 2x, but you do get a very large saving when you go from SLC to MLC. What you do observe is that the difference between a program and an erase shrinks dramatically down. So you have the ability to put many more levels, but now it has come at a cost of A, programming, and B, reliability. And you can keep extrapolating that further. So you can have actually three cells. You'll notice that you have to go in increments of 2 to the power n to actually get 3 bits and 4 bits into the level. And the separation actually scales down much faster. So 1 versus 3 versus 7. So it scales down much faster. But it's possible to do it. On the right, again, it's one of our products. It's a 3-bit per cell part from 25-nanometer node. I think we published it a couple years ago. It clearly shows you can do this. You can have VT distributions which are very fine. We could cycle it well. Its performance was well. So it's doable. But the effort it takes to make this is significantly higher than what it takes to make just a 2-bit part. So putting more levels, great idea, comes at a pretty high engineering cost involved there. So it all goes down to what is good enough. MLC can become good enough, and then suddenly there is really no demand for SLC, and TLC can also become good enough, and then again you'll have no demand for MLC, because to make it, it becomes cheaper.